This is a multiplayer session between the Alaskan Biker and Herman Hum. Kevin asked to play Fortress Keflavik. This scenario is 72 hours long. We've played it once in multiplayer. I commanded the Soviet forces. This time, Kevin has asked for the Soviet forces, so I will control NATO. My orders are to destroy a significant number of ships while protecting my bases from major damage. This scenario map is huge, so most of it will be played from the overall game map. We can see that Stornoway has a number of Buccaneer maritime strike aircraft as well as Nimrod maritime patrol aircraft configured with harpoons and torpedoes. Keflavik has a number of A7 Corsair armed with walleyes, Phantoms armed with laser guided bombs, Eagles, but these are my most important assets, my E3 sentries. My eyes in the sky. They're protected by a couple of squadrons of F-15 Eagles. In the Denmark Strait is a surface action group centered around the battleship Iowa. She has a replenishment vessel accompanying her. My last two units are two diesel-electric submarines. So we've covered the approaches from towards Keflavik from both directions, I hope. The enemy has three air bases, one situated in captured Norway. I repositioned the map windows in order to maximize the game user efficiency. I have decided to rearm my Phantoms for air-to-air missions. The laser-guided bombs are only good for targets when very close. I figure if the enemy is that close, I should have plenty of time to rearm for air to ground. Right now, I want to focus on protecting the base. I have detached the tanker as well as an escort, and I'm sending them to hide out under air cover at Keflavik. The battleship group will maintain a patrol in the Denmark Strait, blocking it, hopefully, from any approach by the Soviets. Osiris will maintain her patrol position between Iceland and the Faroe Islands. We start the scenario. I immediately launch a pair of sentries, and I will order one of them to support Stornoway. Stornoway has no airborne early warning. She's virtually blind and has only six phantoms for her defense. I send the other sentry northeast of Iceland for early warning approaches from the Soviet bases. She detects surface contacts, and we, even at this range, we are able to classify them. It's a pretty significant force. Sovremeny, guided missile destroyers, Udaloy destroyers, Sverdlov light cruiser, Ivan Rogov landing ship, Udaloy, another Udaloy, the Kiev aviation ship, more Sovremenys, more landing ships, Krivaks. That's the invasion force, it looks like. We're holding them at maximum range. Notice the area covered by a single sentry. I have decided to move six of my 18 Phantoms over to Stornoway. They need help desperately. Six Phantoms, British Phantoms, are totally incapable of protecting the base. With a sentry in the air, they actually will have some airborne early warning. I'm going to launch my last sentry right now. The reason I'm really pressing using them up or taxing them is normally we only put one out of three aircraft up, but I need all the airborne warning I can get. I cannot afford to be surprised. So we're going to use all three of them. The game does not require things like crew rest and whatnot. So I know this is not what we might be happening in real life, but I'm considering this a surge, that we're doing this for the short term, even though it may have long term consequences. The ANW does not penalize us for using aircraft in this manner. There are no maintenance failures or crew fatigue factors, unfortunately. The enemy has launched, looks like they're probably forgers, moving at that speed from a naval ship. I've sent Eagles up to protect my sentries. In my previous games, I have been able to fly around the NATO defenses by going far to the north. This is why I'm establishing a barrier of airborne early warning. Hopefully these three sentries will prevent the enemy from being able to cross. The enemy is jamming us. Notice the little X in the corner? I am receiving jamming from the ships. Good for him. He's doing a really good job. So even though the range circle for my detection is that nice yellow range ring, doesn't mean I actually have capability out that far. I don't know how effective my radar is. He could fly right past me, and I still wouldn't notice it due to the jamming. So he's done a really good job degrading my systems. I know where he is, so I'm loading up the maximum number of missiles onto my Buccaneer. In 6 hours, I shall launch a strike. However, the enemy has decided to strike first. We notice there are bogeys coming from most likely Buda in Norway. I'm launching additional interceptors to challenge him. They're moving at high altitude at 460 knots. This could be either a bomber or a fighter, but I think more likely a Badger bomber. More bogeys are detected, moving at 540 knots at medium altitude. He's trying to get under my radar coverage, but we've picked him up. A little bit close. He's managed to get close because he's flying lower, but we still managed to pick him up. There's a number of them here, and I will intercept vectors for my Phantoms. I am ordering the last of my Phantoms into the air. I'm committed my entire Phantom, my British Phantom Force. Good thing that I brought six more in from Iceland, where I'd be in real trouble now. The enemy seems to be using his fighters to screen his bombers. Good move. More bogeys are detected. These are, oh my goodness, moving at 890 knots as super cruise. These must be backfires. I order my newly launched Phantoms to head towards. The Phantoms from Iceland have refueled and are ready. I send them into the air as soon as possible, not a second too soon. He's making his run. I originally wanted to intercept his fighters. They're not radiating, but I'm bringing in Phantoms from Iceland and launching more to intercept those bombers at high altitude. He's only about 350 miles away from Stornoway. He only needs to get within 300 before he can start launching his missiles, most likely. So I immediately pull back from the fighters, call off the attack, and redirect towards the backfires. That was close. I realized that the fighters cannot hurt me as badly as his bombers. But if I don't hurry up, he's going to get within launch range. We climb to high altitude and immediately go to full military power. If he gets within launch range, we're done for. Those guys are fast. I'll send a pair of Sky Flash. Oh, I guess they don't launch. There's that bug again. I'm calling in all the phantoms I can get onto these backfire. There's only five or six of them, but that's enough to scare the living daylights out of me. They are tough birds. I wonder where the rest there. The estimated 2 to 3 regiments of backfires and or badgers. We shot the first down. And a second one goes down in flames. Three more. A pair of missiles each is generally accepted doctrine. Another one. Clean sweep by the RAF. Good job. I am going to order my fighters to try and cut off the enemy as he returns to base when he runs low on fuel. Oh no, looks like the enemy, yeah, he knows I'm here, so his fighters have turned to intercept me. I'm diving down to low altitude and turning off the radar, not giving him a free look. Hopefully I can lose him in the sea clutter. I don't know if it was intentional, but the enemy may have been trying to draw me off with his fighters. If so, if it was intentional, then it was a good job. He almost got it done. His fighters turned back towards me. Normally, I would just ignore the fighters and not even engage. They cannot harm me. But I don't know if there may be additional bombers following behind them. He's leaving the bombers alone, unescorted, while he engages my fighters. I have airborne early warning, which makes all the difference. We get close and I order the phantoms to climb and close on afterburner. Reason is his Alamo missiles have greater range than my Sparrows. I need to get into engagement range as soon as possible. Looks like he's run out of gas. His first aircraft are turning for home. We caught him just at the edge of his operational range. Maybe I'll have some luck. Fox One! Fox One! But he's also fired. Notice he's not even aimed towards me. He's firing to his side. The game allows for this. Yes, it's a game limitation. He shouldn't have to. He should be facing towards me in order to fire. However, the game does not penalize us for not doing so. I tried to go to afterburner to save my Phantom, but it's no use. The follow-up fighters, once the Phantom was shot down, the Sparrows lost guidance and crashed into the earth. His flight mates go to full military power and climb. Amazingly, we've lost him again. He had dove down to 600 meters in order to return at the economical cruise speed and altitude. That means I've lost contact with him. Amazing how just a small dive like that puts him into the sea clutter and virtually invisible. The Phantoms race in on... There he is, pops up again. But due to his lower altitude, we can't engage him. Notice that? He's doing a good job evading. And he's at 601 meters. Notice how close we need to get. All less than 25% of the theoretical maximum range because he's at low altitude. His other fighters are coming. We just picked up the second one. And we're still struggling to engage. Finally. Nothing. Fox 2. Sidewinder off. And he fires one, flips one over his shoulder back at us, and kills us. The Phantom, sole surviving Phantom of the flight, thunders off. And... He's shot down. We got him. His relief flight. Now I'm going to try to engage them because at least they're coming towards me. We'll try to get them both. He's fired. We fired. We're exchanging. Bam! And the Phantom goes down. That's three Phantoms down for the price of maybe two flankers. Not a good exchange. And he's running for home. I'm going to see if I can't try to bag one or two more of them and shoot them in the back, if possible. Meanwhile, in the north, my Phantoms have lost the bombers! Amazing! He must have dove down low. Good job! The puny radar on the Phantom is not very effective. So he's lost the sentry, and he's shaken the Phantoms. The sentry is right over Faroe Islands, and she still can't detect him. Had he gone down to low altitude earlier, I would have been in real trouble. I've called off the pursuit of the flankers. No point running after them when they can flip missiles over their shoulders at me. I'm desperately searching for those badgers. Where did they go? If only the enemy knew. There they are, picked up. Thank goodness I launched relief flights from Keflavik. Holy cow. Had the enemy known just how easily he shook my radar coverage, he'd be using the same route every time and demolishing Keflavik. Looks like my sentries are not as helpful as I had hoped. There are gaps in their radar coverage. This looks like a missile shooting exercise. We're just going to take our time and bring down... There's five of them, so we're going to take our time and not waste missiles. Fox 1! And the first Badger goes down. They're all the way in the GIUK gap without any support. Excellent. We're closing in and shooting them down with both guns and short-range sidewinders. Clean sweep! Home, home, home to rearm and refuel. More bombers coming in. I turned my fighters around too early. I was hoping to rearm and reload, but looks like I'm going to need them. At least these are not being covered by fighters. I have exactly one Phantom in the reload rearm process in reserve. Not very good. Again, we've lost the bombers. They must have dove down low. Good move. Even with a sentry nearly on top of them. Oh, there we go. Picked them up again. They're at 1,300 meters. I'm curious why he didn't bother diving right down to sea level. But I'm not going to look a gift horse in the mouth. Yep, he's maintaining 1,300 meters. That's fine. Just makes it easier for missile solution. The Phantoms go active. Holy cow, this is a pretty big group. We'll go to full military power in order to maximize the engagement range. The closer the speeds are to your targets, the longer the range at which the AI will allow you to fire your weapons. One down. Now we'll use every weapon at hand. Sidewinders are mostly a dogfight missile, but they'll do when the enemy has no defensive weapons beyond his speed and maneuverability. Oops, I think I just fired on another target that's already being fired upon. Yeah, wasted missile. Oh well. The enemy bomber formation is being decimated. He's got no protection, no escorts, nothing to keep me off him. The enemy runs. This is a good behavior, something you would never see from an AI. The AI just is ludicrously brave. It never ever gets frayed, never ever worries about preserving itself. It just keeps coming until they're all destroyed. This is actually a very good human behavior. He's running for home. He's seeing he's taking huge losses, and he's trying to preserve and protect the remainder of his force. Very human, very logical. Unfortunately, he's just got bad timing. I've got too many fighters, and they all, had I burned up more fuel, had they been less range available, I would not be able to catch him, because he's running at 890 knots, and the only way for me to catch him is to pursue on afterburner. That burns an incredible amount of fuel. He likely would have gotten away if my fuel state had been lower. Fox One! Fox One! One down. One survived. Re-engage. Fox One, Fox One. Success. I'm pretty low on fuel now after that sprint on afterburner. He's doing a lot of good things. Too bad he had come in over the mountains, and that allowed him to, that forced him to climb, which made him easier for the sentry to detect. There's a lot of holes in my radar coverage. I shouldn't be so confident. More bombers approaching. The two Eagles on combat air patrol escorting the sentry moved to intercept. It's a turkey shoot. He did manage to get fairly close before detection by the sentry, though. The enemy jamming is pretty good, but insufficient. The bombers are swept again. The enemy has sent a guided missile destroyer, Sovremini, southward. That's fine. I'll try to meet him with the diesel-electric Osiris. More, looks like more fighters or fighter bombers are approaching. After the last shootout, which I don't think I got the best of, I can't afford to risk all my interceptors in air-to-air battles. I'm trying to preserve them and to shoot down bombers, which actually might damage the base. The enemy's over Faro, and we are retreating towards Stornoway. He's not radiating. I'll fight him if I absolutely must over Stornoway, but I'm going to try to draw out his fuel. If the enemy had some bombers behind them, I could be in some big trouble right now. A number of forgers are detected, and I'm moving my phantoms in to intercept. The enemy seems to be quite happy to just sit over Pharaoh's. I'm happy to just let him sit there at the moment. The enemy group appears to be breaking up and returning to base. Great! Looks like one great long stream of forger. Another shooting gallery. He's run himself out of gas, and we just see a stream of fighters returning, trying to return to base. Low on fuel, unable to maneuver. It's a turkey shoot. The Phantoms just picked them off. This should be like shooting a string of ducks at the local carnival. Look at them walk. Quack, quack, bam! one by one. They're shot out of the air. This is why you need to keep close track on the endurance and range left to your fighters. If you turn back at maximum range, this is the kind of slaughter that can happen. Your planes are out of fuel and out of luck. It's just slaughter. The more I kill now, the less I have to worry about later. Every forger that survives can still shoot down an Orion or other maritime patrol aircraft. My Phantoms arrive, and we will try to shoot down as many as possible with our Sparrows and Sidewinders. We'll climb to maximum altitude in order to get the best radar coverage. A few may actually escape, unfortunately. We'll try to prevent that. Oh no, look in the south. I've gotten too close to this guy. Okay, we'll fire on him. Then the ducks fire back! Shooting ducks in the gallery, but the ducks are armed. So even with the short-range aphids that the forges carry, they still have some teeth. The Sovremini is doing a pretty good job jamming our radar, but she can't protect the forgers enough. We've lost a number of them, and I'm going to see if I can't chase them down and pick them up again. It's worth the gas, but we want to stay away from Sovremini. Her missiles, luckily, are only very short-ranged, so 10 miles or so is, as long as we stay more than 10 miles away, or Sidewinder range away from her, we should be okay. We have to be careful we picked one up. We have to be careful as the forgers run for home, they get closer and closer to their surface-to-air missile bubble provided by the Slava. Slava has surface-to-air missiles that reach out over 100 miles, so they could easily be drawing us into their SAM range. We're staying away from the Sovremini. It's nice of the enemy to detach him. He's all alone out here without the support of his long-range surface-to-air missile ships. He's still not defenseless, but he doesn't have as many missiles as the entire group. There's the Udaloy, and where the Udaloy is, there probably is going to be a Slava and Kiev. We pick up one more. I've decided to break off the attack rather than risk running into range of the surface-to-air missiles. We'll turn off the radar and dive down low in order to land. So he's somewhere in this area. The enemy has retired from Pharos, so we have repositioned the airborne early warning sentry over the islands. I've launched all the Buccaneers and all the Nimrod armed with air-to-surface missiles. We're going to try to get a strike in on the amphibious force. To take out the Sovremini, I have launched a number of Corsairs. They have shorter-ranged walleye missiles. The walleyes have a range of approximately 35 miles, so they can launch outside the surface-to-air missile bubble of the Sovremini, which has missiles for only about 10 miles. More fighters appear from Buda. We are going to once again retreat from Pharos. We're going to give it to them. I'm sending the Phantoms out around. I'm going to see if I can flank him and approach from his port side. His radar is only effective for the approximately 60 degrees or so in front. I am going to try and approach him from the flank where his radar is not, where there is no radar coverage. Maybe I can blind sight him. We're diving down low into the clutter. I do not believe he's detected us. This is the advantage of having airborne radar coverage. Our eyes in the sky are providing us with intercept vectors while the enemy must fly blindly. As we close, I think we've evaded detection. They climb and accelerate to full power. I estimate where we can start firing and turn on the radar. Fox 1! Fox 1! A kill! The enemy seems to proceed obliviously into the kill zone. His radar warning receivers must have told him that he was being, that there was radar intercept or fire control radar locked upon him. He's paying the price for not paying attention and for not coordinating with his bombers. Had there been bombers, he's wasting the lives of his airmen, in my opinion. Clean sweep. It's Miller time. We have regained air supremacy over the Pharos. The sentry heads back to her patrol position over Faro Island. The Orions are launched from Keflavik to join the Buccaneers and Nimrods. The Corsairs head for Sovremini. sovereignty. She still has surface-to-air missiles, but I think that the walleyes can penetrate. We climb to missile release altitude of 1,000 meters. With 8 or 16 walleyes, I think we should be able to overwhelm her and sink her. She still has close-in Gatling guns as well as surface-to-air missiles. We come into range and release the walleyes. The walleye is given targeting correction data from the Corsairs. They have a data link. So I'm not going to turn the Corsairs around. We're just going to loiter and provide additional guidance. The Sovereignty puts up a good fight. She's blasting away, yep, and she gets some. She gets many. She's doing a pretty good job, but she does not have the support of her shipmates. And she's hit and obliterated. In the north, the surface group is redetected. I will use the Sea Eagles and Harpoons to draw down the enemy to saturate his defenses. If I'm lucky, I'll get a hit, but I don't expect a hit. But at least every missile I fire at him will cause him to waste surface-to-air missiles defending himself. There's Slava. She's a tough nut. And she's alerted. So I don't expect many hits or any. At least I can suck out all of her surface-to-air missiles, the grumbles. Different waves of bombers close on the Slava. I'm trying to adjust the different speeds for the attack groups so that they arrive at the same time, generally. The enemy appears to be running, but Slava is between us and the transports. Right where she should be. The bombers drop down to very low altitude. Right now, they're already under threat from the Slava, if they are detected. But she requires radar lock-on in order to fire her grumble, so we're below the radar horizon. The first group, a Buccaneer attack squadron, arrives within range, and they loiter waiting for the follow-on groups. We want to fire at the same time the Sea Eagles and the Harpoons generally have the same attack speed. Therefore, if we, even though they have a different attack range, hopefully we will be able to saturate them if all the missiles appear at the same time. Three groups are now within range. The timing is pretty good. We are only waiting less than a minute for all four groups to be within range of the target. All missiles are released. These are fire and forget weapons, so the strikers turn away. Notice there are 64 weapons targeted on the Slava. How many of them will hit? No idea. Because unlike in Harpoon 3, once you, if you had a solid contact on your target and fired, you are guaranteed to hit it. That doesn't happen in A&W. It could go anywhere. We picked up two forgers, looks like. The Phantoms will try to pick them off. They're just hovering there, like sitting ducks. The sparrows make short work out of them. A clean sweep. Although there are still claimed to be 64 weapons targeted on the Slava, nope, now there's only 12. Yeah, it seems as though we've hit everything but the Slava. That's how silly this is. And it doesn't seem as though we even drew out many of her deadly grumble. We have a number of ships dead in the water. Looks like they're probably sinking. Landing ships, amphibious ships. The enemy intent to invade Iceland is probably over. A fulcrum radar is detected. The two eagles protecting the sentry move to intercept. We examine the Alamo weapons that they probably carry, and the range is 45 to 49 miles. The range of an eagle sparrow is 61 miles, so we have approximately 50% advantage in range. Because of this, we decide to close directly on the targets. We should be able to hit them well before they hit us. The problem is, I will keep the plane aimed towards the target so that their radar provides guidance. As I close, I also enter the enemy engagement range. If I can fire at him, he can soon fire at me. Yep, he's got a pair off at me. I have to make... He's turning away, even though theoretically he shouldn't be able to, but that's fine. That's part of the game. He's turning. I'm going to afterburner to try and throw off his aim. We strike home and pull away on afterburner. The second eagle releases her birds, but we've lost contact. The enemy has dove down low and we can't get him out of the clutter. The eagle wants his pound of flesh, so he continues the pursuit and fires on a vaguely detected target, hoping that his radar will lock up in time to guide it home. The enemy has also returned fire and destroys the eagle before the sparrows hit their target. Once guidance is lost, the sparrows fall into the sea. Not a good exchange rate. We keep an eye on the enemy, on the Kiev and the Slava. Because of their huge range, it's 110 mile range of his surface-to-air missiles. I'm quite puzzled as to why he detached his primary air defense ship and the carrier away from the amphibious ships they were charged to protect. There's a group of four fighters sitting virtually motionless. We move in to claim them. We don't have to aim directly at them. I'm trying to aim slightly off axis so that they have a harder time returning fire. The enemy has gone to afterburner. Good move. My Eagles give pursuit. Two more are shot down, but he gets one of my Eagles. Three enemy fighters for one Eagle. Pretty much even. A number of bogeys are detected on the top of the map. Looks like they're running at low altitude. The profile and speed make it appear to be backfire. They're trying to get around my sentry. Notice how the sentry is no longer receiving jamming. This has helped it a great deal. Without the degradation, if the bombers are fairly easily detected. However, had there been electronic warfare jamming cluttering up my radar screens, I might very well have missed them. The Eagles go to full speed and launch their Sparrows. Virtually with impunity, as the backfires have no air-to-air weapons, except for their incredible speed. Three are brought down. We give pursuit and relief extra fighters are launched. Behind them, we have detected another group of slower moving aircraft. These are probably bear bombers, given their speed. The incredible speed of the backfire, 800 at super cruise, means that even though my fighters are on full military power, we are unable to catch them. If we go to afterburner, we just ran short of fuel, and the enemy continues on. But we have a number of Phantoms and Eagles rising from the airfield at Keflavik. The enemy has gotten bold. He's attacking on three different axes. Good coordination. He's got fighters coming after the sentries, bears coming across the north, and backfires drawing away my fighters. The Eagles protecting the sentry react. We go to afterburner speed to try and throw off the enemy ability to return fire. When dealing with enemy fighters, we salvo the entire complement of Sparrows. These are maneuverable fighters and not just big lumbering bombers. Both fighters are brought down, and the Eagles retire to rearm and reload. We're keeping an eye on the bears in the north. I think the enemy believes he's gotten past us. If he had been jamming, he might very well have done so. The incredible speed of those backfires is making it difficult to plot intercept paths, as all the fighters have much slower, even at full military power, the fighters are slower than the supersonic backfire. All the fighters climb to high altitude and increase speed. We barely make the intercept, and the Phantoms are forced to sprint in on the final leg on afterburner. Without fear from retaliation, the fighters slaughter the backfire. And move in to finish the job with sidewinders. The enemy probably believes he's drawn me off, leaving the bears to approach unmolested. Could have been true. Almost was. He's making a beeline for Keflavik. Additional fighters attempting to cut them off have to hurry. The range of the missiles carried by the bears is approximately 300 nautical miles. And he's already at 400, so it's going to be a race. But I think we'll win this one. He thinks he surprised me. The surprise is on him, as the Phantoms arrive and unleash their Sparrows. The crews are certainly brave as they continue into the direct line of fire. None of the subsonic bears survive. My Nimrods, Orions, and Corsairs have rearmed. We see that the enemy amphibious group, survivors, are virtually undefended. A few destroyers and frigates remain. The carrier is off to the south, and the main air defense ship, Slava, is way to the south. Where could they be going? The battleship group has detected a torpedo launch. She's under submarine attack. She moves to flank speed and immediately attempts to evade. But we can't even tell where the torpedoes are coming from, other than they're in the water. The Nimrod is going to try and pick off the Sverdlov light cruiser. She has the longest range and for anti-air defense, even though it's only gun defense. The Sovremeny and Udaloy class destroyers are too far away. He's got a number of torpedoes, including a Type 6576 wake-homing torpedo, moving at 50 knots. This is one phenomenal weapon with a range of over 50 nautical miles. One hit from a Type 65 might be enough to even sink a battleship. I've sent the Corsairs in with Maverick and Walleyes. The shorter range of the Walleye is only 35 nautical miles, but that's okay because there are no long-range air defenses on this group. My orders are to sink the amphibious and cargo vessels. I do not need to engage the Slava or the Kiev. It would be nice, but my objective is to sink the Marines. The Corsair climbs to 1,000 meters in order to release her Walleye. She will focus on the killing the Sverdlov. This heavily armored cruiser can probably take a large number of hits, so we're aiming all of our remaining Walleyes at her. Once again, the Corsairs will loiter and provide mid-course guidance. The Corsairs, armed with Mavericks, move in on the defenseless transports. Chilikin is a replenishment ship, but she appears to be dead in the water. Sverdlov takes several hits and is blown out of the water. She's sinking. We cannot tell if the Chilikin is actually sinking or not, so we need to conduct reconnaissance and actually fly over. It looks like she's only heavily damaged. As they make their pass over, the Corsairs strafe her with their guns and head towards the next ship in line. They reward her with two pairs of Mavericks, leaving her sinking. The Ivan Rogov is a multi-purpose amphibious ship. We fire off about 8 Maverick towards her. Unfortunately, we forgot that the Rogov has some pretty good defenses, so we will add another 10. She's hit and damaged in the first wave. We should have fired more, but that's my error. She survives a second wave and is still damaged. We fire the remaining 8 Maverick, or we fire 4 more Maverick at her. And then 4 more. She's one tough ship. Mavericks are fire and forget weapons and self-guiding, so we'll pull off target as soon as they drop off our racks. And she's still afloat. The Orions decide to attack her with 8 harpoons. Rogov is struck repeatedly and is dead in the water. This leaves only one tanker from the original group. The battleship group appears to have successfully evaded the torpedo attack. Buccaneers, rearmed with iron bombs, head in towards the tanker. As she has no escorts within range, they can carry short-range weapons directly to the target. They toggle off their 1,000-pound Mark 13 bombs, 24 of them in all. The tanker is struck repeatedly and explodes, sinking and on fire. A submarine has been detected, a Victor 1, right in the path of the battleship group. She's danger close. Joseph Daniels immediately fires an ASROC. And launches her helicopter. The group moves to evade, but the submarine has already fired. We have detected launch transient. That's why the submarine turned red, hostile. We'll try to get the helicopter off the Josephus Daniels. She takes a hit and breaks in two. Let's see if the Sea Sprite can't exact revenge. We'll activate the sonar and sonobuoys to see where we're dropping. The Sea Sprite drops sonobuoys to localize. Look how quickly we lost track of the target. She's moving quickly, trying to break contact and launch a second attack. We're lucky it's a Victor 1. There she is. We put one into the water. If she was a more modern submarine, there would be 3, 4, maybe 6 or 8 torpedoes in the water already. Good job on the part of my opponent, getting that close to launch a torpedo. The submarine, Victor 1, takes a hit and breaks up. Exchanging one submarine for one cruiser is not a good deal. The enemy seems to have withdrawn his ships towards Norway. The Slava is making a beeline for Stornoway. Good move on his part, as I've used all the long-range weapons in my ammo dumps. The Osiris moved to intercept, but her maximum speed was only 18, and the enemy was doing at least 23 knots. He increases speed as he closes on Stornoway. Looks like he wants to bring it under the lash of his guns. I've evacuated the surviving Phantoms and Buccaneers, as well as the Nimrod patrol aircraft. He closes on the base and hammers it. As I cannot approach him without committing suicide with my short-range Mavericks. This is a good move on his part. Here I thought I could just sit back and wait for victory when Kevin decides to come in and attack my base at Stornoway. He does it so well that he has obliterated the entire base. Not a trace of it is left. Good job, Kevin. I shot down a score of his bombers, most of his fighters, and sank his transports, but he still found a way to screw my plans. That is the making of a great player, in my opinion. One who refuses to lose and finds a way to win. Even though Kevin could not win, according to his orders, he said that there is always a way to, when you cannot win, the next definition of winning is preventing the other side from winning. By smashing my base at Stornoway, I will be unable to accomplish my victory conditions, which said I had to protect my base 25 units from loss. And Kevin persists. He now has a slow-moving bomber appears to be moving, traveling across the southern edge of the map. As well, a submarine has been detected next to Keflavik, only because it came up to periscope depth. It's a Victor 3, a high-class nuclear submarine, and a capable opponent. The Orion I had on patrol duty near the mouth of the bay immediately turns and attacks, dropping torpedo after torpedo after torpedo. This guy's good, or I'm just very poor in luck. The reason why one torpedo is dropped at a time is this is likely how submarines would be prosecuted in the real world. The game does not penalize me for dropping multiple torpedoes. However, supposedly, multiple torpedoes would interfere with one another if this was a real combat situation. So I will try to simulate that as best I can. Of course, we cannot fully simulate the game because we can fly back and forth and turn on a dime. Finally, the submarine is sunk. In the south, we've caught up with a low-flying aircraft. He's slow-moving, but he has increased speed. We're going to go in and identify and then prosecute him with sidewinders. And in order to save the more precious and limited Sparrow missiles, a pair of sidewinders should do the job. The bogey is blown out of the air. Notice that there is no jamming coming from anywhere. My sentry easily picked up the interloper at virtually maximum range. Had there been more jamming, he could very likely have prevented the loss. The scenario duration expires, and I have lost. I've sunk plenty of ships, but I was unable to protect 25 units from taking 100% damage. Kudos to a player like Kevin for never giving up and looking to play spoiler, even in the face of great losses. That is a great credit and speaks well of a man who has high morale. We can see that the losses are extreme. Other lessons learned. I think that if there had been more jamming or electronic warfare upon my sentries, the bombers probably could have slipped through. There were many instances whereupon I did not detect them until very close because they had flown both low and there was jamming. The few times I think that I picked them up at long range were in the absence of jamming, also when they were coming over the mountains, which forced them to fly a little bit higher.